يقول أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا لو من هذه الله فهو المهتد وأن يضل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم وبارك. تفضل سليمان. سليمان has a question before we start. Sleeping, is that what you're saying?
Yes. Snippet.
Okay. Small,
big difference.
Okay, go ahead. So, I have some comments on the khutbah, we'll take them and then we'll continue.
You're talking about covering the mistakes or sins.
Yeah. Yeah.
What if somebody is a serial murderer, you know that this guy is killing people, should you still have to cover the prayer?
Yeah, this is something that I didn't have time to cover at the end of the khutbah. Usually, we talk about it. I'll take it from a different perspective. Is backbiting halal or haram? Al-ghiba, halal or haram?
Haram.
Haram, right? طيب. When the ghiba becomes permissible, I'm not gonna say halal, permissible.
When you're warning the Muslimin.
Yeah, when you warn the people from the evil of somebody. So we can talk about it. You can bring it up easily. And say, guys, be careful of this guy. He's doing this. He's doing haram stuff. So you can do that. Okay? The same applies to somebody like who is actually, spreading corruption or doing something bad, you know. You bring it up and you don't cover him. The other thing is that when you, like if the people don't know about it, they might be deceived by this and get closer to him. Let's talk about example that always happens. A brother comes to the masjid and start like taking money from the people. So he took money from you, he took money from me, he took money from other brother. So another brother coming to me. So I know that he's actually taking advantage on the people. And a brother coming to me asking me, here it's not his right that I cover him. I have to uncover him and tell the people, warn the people from his evil. So that's the only case. Allahu a'lam. I have lots to say in this area. There's lots of example in this area, but yani, that's the main point about it. Wallahu a'lam. But again, it depends on your evaluation of the situation. Yani, it's not what you see. It's dangerous. I might see it's okay. Yani, we always, the imams fall in this problem. Last month I had two problems because of this. When you give a recommendation for somebody is proposing to a family. It's actually a father coming to you or calling you, this guy is proposing to my daughter. What do you know about him? Concealing, screening, covering his mistakes, it's a khiyana. And you're actually done, you're not honest with this family. And then later on they can come after you and say that you misled us. The other problem is that the people don't get it. You tell them the truth, they go tell him and he come fight with you. That what happened last month. A very close person to me is, you know, proposing to a girl from the States. States, man. They called me and sent somebody. So I told them, Akhi, here is the good points. Here is the things that you should be aware of. He told them everything. And he told them, Sheikh Sharif told me 1, 2, 3, 4. So he came to me. How come you say that about me? I told him, Akhi. He told me, the guy asking me, would you marry him, your daughter? I told him not. So he told him exactly the same thing. So he came to me and said that. Well, why are you telling that? Because I will never give you my daughter. So easily, Akhi, my daughter is 2 years, 4 years old, you're 30. So, you don't have to, you have to be wise, but at the end of the day, you will be in trouble. Telling you. But you do what you have to do. I told him, Akhi, wallah, that's the truth. I said what I believe in. Anyway, time. Last week, tanibta alhamdulillah. Now, this is what I'm saying. And I'm going to say, Sahih Allah, Sahih Allah, Sahih Allah. Khasa tuwaliya mandul. Anyway, last week we said that the main the big turnout in the life of the Prophet ﷺ was Fath Makkah. So you look at the situation, the 13 years that he spent in Mecca, very weak. The Muslims are weak, they left everything, they moved to Medina, they stayed over there, fights, you know, struggle, power struggle between them and Quraysh, until that year came, the eighth year after Hijrah, where the Prophet ﷺ had the chance to come back to Mecca. And we said that Fatih Mecca was a result of the break of the treaty of Al-Hudaybiyah from Quraysh side. When Abu Bakr, the Banu Bakr, the tribe of Banu Bakr, they killed some from Khuza'ah, which is a clear and straight breach and break of the treaty of Al-Hudaybiyah. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came towards Mecca with 10,000 Muslims. First time in the Islamic history until that moment, the Muslims reached that number. 10,000 people, they coming with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam towards Mecca. فالنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, you know, try to cover the news, and we know what happened from Sayyidina, who sent the letters. What's his name? What's the name of the Sahabi who sent the letter with the lady in the braid? Abu Bakr? Baltaha? Abu Baltaha? Abu Baltaha? Good, very, very close, yani. Good. Hatib ibn Baltaha, very close. Ibn Balta'a like Abu Balta'a, the same, alhamdulillah. So Sayyidina Hatib ibn Balta'a sent a letter toward the people of Quraysh, and he gave his excuse. You know what, my excuse is that I'm a poor man, I don't have family, and I wanted to give myself strength when I go back to Mecca. Didn't work. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him about it. Came, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to Wadi Dhuhran, or Dhuhran, this area at the borders of Mecca. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam camped over there with the Muslims. They came and they were trying to enter Mecca. Abu Sufyan was like taking a tour just with two people with him. And then they got to know what happened. Sayyidina Al-Abbas ibn Abdul Muttalib, the uncle of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, took Abu Sufyan to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he had to, by the way, some people say that Abu Sufyan, until that moment, he didn't want to be a Muslim. Everybody's looking at you now. Like in the Jum'ah, I'm giving the khutbah and Sulaiman is fixing the microphone. The whole message is looking at Sulaiman. Ya akhi, but khalas, he's fixing. I announced that Sulaiman, please fix the microphone. For everybody knows that Sulaiman is fixing the microphone, but the Sheikh is saying something should be new, inshallah ta'ala. When they're looking at Sulaiman, subhanAllah, maybe he's attractive, that's why. Anyway. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as we said last week, Sayyidina Abbas asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to give Abu Sufyan something. And that thing was?
Prophet's cloak?
What
is that called? Cloak?
No. He told him to give him something, not cloth. Something as an honor.
Right.
What was it?
Those who want to be saved.
Exactly. Yeah. If you enter the house of Abu Sufyan, you will be saved. That was for the announcement that was made at the entrance of Mecca from the Muslims, that anybody stays in his home will be safe. Anybody stays in Al-Masjid Al-Haram will be safe. Anybody goes to the house of Abu Sufyan will be safe. Abu Sufyan got in, and I said last week he was not that convinced to be Muslim. Eventually, he was one of the greatest Sahaba ever. Sayyidina Abu Sufyan, when we read about his history, yani great Sahaba, inshallah ta'ala. Anyway, that was the first part that we talked about. Khalas. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam showed Abu Sufyan the power of the Muslims, all the tribes coming to Mecca, and Abu Sufyan went to the people of Mecca and gave them that announcement. Guys, you have to be aware. Today, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is coming with an army that you will never be able to face. Stay home, come to my house, go to Al-Masjid Al-Haram if you want to save and, you know, be secure. Who? At that time, when he met with the Prophet ﷺ, when Sayyidina Al-Abbas took him to the Prophet ﷺ, he took his shahada right away.
So after he saw the tribes coming?
No. Before he saw the tribes coming. Because basically what happened, Sayyidina Abu Sufyan was walking with two other people. Just walking. So they saw the fire. Imagine that a camp that has 10,000 people. And they start a fire to make food and stuff like that. So he saw the fire and they start guessing, who are those people? The tribe of so-and-so. No, but they're not that that great in number. So-and-so, they're not that great in number. At that time, Sayyidina al-Abbas came. So he took, actually, before Sayyidina al-Abbas, the eyes of the Prophet, you know, they took, the scout, we said last week, they took him as a prisoner of war. Sayyidina al-Abbas gave him the protection. His cousin, at the end of the day, Abu Sufyan, and the Prophet are cousins, right? So he took him to the Prophet. At that point, he accepted Islam. When he was leaving, going back to Mecca, the Prophet ordered Sayyidina al-Abbas to keep him at the entrance of the valley to see all the tribes coming in, the Muslim army, to give him that, yeah.
But he wasn't sincere in the Shahada when he first said it?
La ilaha, he said it. In one of the narrations, he said it that, as for La ilaha illallah, I have no doubt. As for you are Muhammad is a messenger of Allah, I'm still shaking. But he said it. Okay? Anyway, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam divided the Muslim army into 3 parts. Right, left, and front. And he entered Mecca sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in a very, very humble way. Yani imagine after all of this, and what they did to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Mecca in the 13 years, and after he went to Medina, he didn't enter Mecca as like a victorious one, like that he has the upper hand. No. He went very, like, as we say, down to earth, humble sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he was reading the start of Surah Al-Fatih, the few ayat at the beginning of Surah Al-Fatih, إِنَّا فَتَحْنَا لَكَ فَتْحًا مُبِينًا. We have given you a great conquest, a great opening, which is the opening and the conquest of Mecca. And I said before, using the word conquest doesn't give any negative connotation. It is conquest. The Prophet ﷺ went with power and he conquered Mecca. It's not about that he opened, they gave him the key and he opened Mecca. They will never give him the key. And Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab, when he got the keys of Bayt al-Maqdis of Jerusalem, after, we can say that he opened it. But then he conquered Mecca, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The people of Quraysh, they knew that they cannot face the Muslim army at that moment. What they thought of, and this, subhanAllah, some people, they're doing this right now. And some countries, actually, they're doing this. Let's not talk about politics, but some people, they use others, they pay them as their army, paid army. Then they send them to Yemen. So some people, they don't have army, they don't have somebody to believe in what they believe in. So they hire people, give you money, and you go fight for us. Then those people are always in the front lines, because they're paid. You can't say no, we'll put you in the front line. They were called awbash. So the word, we use it, awbash. Awbash, people who has no honor, no dignity at all. For the people of Quraysh hired some awbash from around Mecca, some like Murtazaqa, people who are paid, like paid army from around the tribes around Mecca, and put them in the front line. And they said, you know what, if they get victory, we'll join them. If they, they have the upper hand, we'll join them. If they got defeated, alhamdulillah, we're safe. That's the plan. وكانت قريش قد وبشت أوباشا أي جمعت جموعا متفرقة من قبائل لا أنساب لهم ولا أنساب بينهم وقالت قريش تقدم هؤلاء الأوباش فإن أصابوا أي انتصروا كنا معهم أو نقدم هؤلاء الأوباش فإن انتصروا كنا معهم وإن أصيبوا أعطينا الذي سئلنا أي صلحنا المسلمين يعني if they got victorious we're with them if they got defeated We already got a nice offer from Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We accept it. What is it? To stay at home. Everybody goes to his home. We're safe.
Sheikh, I have a question.
Good.
We all agree that the attack, they weren't expected. It was a surprise attack on them.
On whom?
On their Mecca.
Yeah.
They were the leader of the Muslims. Were.
They were not.
So when would they have time to hide these Awbash people?
No, but the Prophet ﷺ camped and he sent Abu Sufyan. Okay,
So
it takes time. No, it takes time to do that.
A day or two or something like that?
I don't know. I didn't read it exactly. How long was it? Maybe more. Amin, do you have an idea? How many days? Amin, how's in a Muslim? Anyway, Allahu Akbar, لقد جاء قائد فريق اليمنية في المسجد المسيحي عمار بن بلتحة. ماشي عمار، الله يسهل لك عمار. مش عاجبك ولا ايه؟ ايه يا حلمي؟ على طول فيش كبسة، انا قلت لكم هتقعدوا هجيب لكم كبسة. خليكم قاعدين لحد الفجر ان شاء الله هتيجي الكبسة. فإنوي النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم that's exactly what happened with those Awbash. سيدنا أبو هريرة رضي الله عنه is narrating the hadith. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم called سيدنا أبو هريرة and he told him, يا أبو هريرة call الأنصار for me. Everyone from الأنصار I need him right now. Why? Just bring them all. That he came, all of them, الأنصار to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال للأنصار أرأيتم أوباش قريش. Can you see those أوباش that Quraysh brought? Yes, we see them. I don't want to see anybody of them. Kill them all. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told the Ansar this clearly. فسيدنا أبو هريرة رضي الله عنه قال فانطلقنا فما شاء أحد منا أن يقتل أحدا منهم إلا قتل وما فعلوا بنا شيء. سيدنا أبو هريرة said that we marched, we listened to the order of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we went, we killed, every one of us killed one. يعني whoever wants to kill one of them, he kills him. And they didn't touch us. Again, I'll go back to the same point that I raised. And if you're hiring somebody to fight on your behalf, he's not gonna, he doesn't have the same, you know, aqidah that you have. He's not gonna, he doesn't care. He will flee and he will be killed easily. يعني he doesn't believe in what you believe in. Anyway, they didn't do anything. Right away, the Ansar, they get rid of all of those awbash as mentioned in the authentic hadith on the authority of Sayyidina Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu. سيدنا أبو سفيان at that moment came to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم وقال يا رسول الله أبيدت خضراء قريش لا قريش بعد اليوم. He came to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and he told him يا رسول الله we got destroyed. We got destroyed. There is no more Quraysh after today. I need help. What can I do? He told him يا أخي say what I told you. Announce to the people that they're safe. So سيدنا أبو سفيان repeated the same announcement again. Whoever stay in his house, he will be safe. Whoever stays in the Masjid, in the Masjid Haram, he will be safe. Whoever stays in my house, in Abu Sufyan's house, will be safe. And وَمَنْ أَلْقَى And he added this one. وَمَنْ أَلْقَى سِلَاحَهُ فَهُوَ آمُ Not only you stay inside one of these places, now, if you're even in the streets of Mecca, but you drop your weapon or your sword off, down, you will be safe. You walk like that. You will be safe. فالنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, in order to give confirmation to the announcement of Abu Sufyan, he repeated the whole thing. Again, whoever stays in the Masjid Haram, he will be safe. Whoever stays in his house, he'll be safe. And whoever drops his weapon, his sword, he will be safe. تأكيداً وإقراراً لها. فلما سمع الأنصار طيب. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم now is coming with المهاجرين and الأنصار. المهاجرين, the people of Mecca, they came back to their homes, they're happy. الأنصار, they're coming for one thing only. For Allah, for the words of Tawheed. To follow the orders of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, following the orders of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So they're coming not to their hometown, they're gonna go back eventually to Medina. But when they see, or they saw what happened from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as confirmation and support that he gave to Abu Sufyan, when he said that the people, if they stay in Abu Sufyan's house, they will be saved, the shaitan start playing in the minds and the brains of Al-Ansar. قال وكأن الرجل حن إلى قريته. قال exactly أما الرجل يعنون رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فأدركته رغبة في قريته. طب they said in there to themselves. They didn't say that to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Al-Ansar, they said to themselves, you know, to one another, Yani it seems that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wishes to stay in Mecca. He doesn't want to fight. He's not here to fight. He's here, it's his people, his family. فأخبر الله تبارك وتعالى رسوله بذلك. Right away, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the statement as it is to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he called upon al-Ansar. فدعاهم النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وقال يا معشر الأنصار قلتم أما الرجل فأدركته رغبة في قريته. يعني he called al-Ansar and he told them, يعني have you said that I wish to stay I wish to stay in Mecca? Yeah, they said yes. We said that. But يعني, I think most of us, we know the statement that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, but they told the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, يا رسول الله, يعز علينا أن تتركنا وتقيم في أهلك. فقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, إن الله ورسوله يصدقانكم ويعذرانكم. يعني they said, يا رسول الله, we said it. We said it. And it was because of what, it's hard on us that you leave us and you stay in Mecca and you came to us. فالنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم told him, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, they believe what you said. That it's because that you love me and you want me to be with you. And Allah and his messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم give you the excuse for saying that. Because it's out of love. ثم قال صلى الله عليه وسلم لهم كلا ما أفعل الذي ظننت. I'll never do it. I will never do it. إني رسول الله هاجرت إلى الله وإليكم المحيا محياكم والممات مماتكم. I'm the messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم. I have migrated for the sake of Allah towards you. I'll live with you. I'll die in your place. المحيا محياكم, always as long as I'm alive, I'm with you. والممات مماتكم, then I will die at your place. I will die in Medina. But he didn't, right? He didn't die in Medina, right?
He died
in Egypt. One of the great pictures and scenes that you see in the Fath Mecca, and by the way, wallahi, something I read today, yani amazing, that how those people, the people can twist anything. Yani, the people of Quraysh had inside Al-Ka'ba something for a great prophet and his two sons doing something haram in the picture. And they have it in Al-Ka'ba. Like today, for example, when somebody has the picture of Isa alayhi salam, did you see him? No, why the Isa? Okay? When some people, for example, have the picture of Mary, and when you come to them and say that they accuse us that the hijab is oppression, hijab is not fard, and all of these things. And we tell them, okay, do you believe in the picture that you have for Mary? Yes. But she has hijab. No, it was something else. Anyway, for people twist the facts. I'll tell you why I'm saying that. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, one of the things that he did right away, right after he entered Mecca, he asked the Sahaba to demolish all the idols that were around Kaaba. How many were there?
3,000.
No, 3,000. Mila 3,000. Khalini sakata. Yes. There were 360 sonam. 360. Imagine, subhanAllah. يعني انت, you want to worship this one? You go worship him. You want to, يعني subhanAllah, very free country. You worship what you want. You worship this, you worship that, it's fine. You eat this. Sometimes you have idols, gods from dates. Nice. Should be nice. They worship them and they eat them after. SubhanAllah al-Azim. Anyway, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam started with his own hands destroying and demolishing these idols. فكان يهوي بقوسه إليها فتتساقط على الأرض. And يعني him and the Sahaba, they were using the ayah in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَقُلْ جَاءَ الْحَقُّ وَزَهَقَ الْبَاطِلِ إِنَّ الْبَاطِلَ كَانَ زَهُوقٌ. يعني now it's the time of the truth. Truth comes, باطل, the falsehood away now, which is all of these idols and Islam that they worship. 60 و 300. Solomon, you were not 360, they were 60 and 300. والله العظيم أنا في ناس هنا sleeping أنا يعني بتصحصحها يا شباب. 360 صنم النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لطخ. The people of Quraysh, they had a picture inside الكعبة for whom? For سيدنا إبراهيم and سيدنا إسماعيل and سيدنا إسحاق. Doing what? Doing أزلام. أزلام means Who knows the meaning of الأزلام؟ In Arab. يا أيها الذين آمنوا إنما الخمر والميسر والأنصاب والأزلام. This is an ayah. قول يا من يمنية أهل اللغة. مين؟ مين هنا؟ طب حد مصري يفتح نفسنا. Anybody knows the meaning؟ قول يا له أي. ما السودان أهل السودان هم بتوع اللغة. الإيه؟ يعني ايه اللجام؟ اللجام بتاع الجمل؟ لا بجد والله، انت قصدك كده؟ لا لا مش اللجام لا.
الاضطراب الاسلام؟
ايوه ايوه كده ايوه ايوه ايوه. انت مش عارف تقولها بس قلتها؟ ماشي يا دكتور ايهاب. الازلام the divining arrows. You know what when they were saying that this which is basically something of fortune telling or expecting or predicting something in the future based on these herbs. For they have a picture, they had a picture for Ibrahim alayhi salam, Ismail alayhi salam, and Ishaq doing this, which is absolutely haram. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that in Surah Al-Ma'idah. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu innama al-khamru kham. Yani it's not liquors, only khamr is haram. So, إنما الخمر والميسر gambling والأنصاب what's an أنصاب? It's close to idols but sometimes like crucifying يعني getting idol for somebody. You know what? Like the idols of the أصنام that came after سيدنا نوح عليه السلام. Those five people that's mentioned ويغوث ويعوق ونسر. يعني when you have somebody died and you start crucifying his idol and you start worshipping it. والأزلام ريجي سم من عمل الشر. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لطخ هذه الصورة وهم يستقسمون بالأزلام وكانت هذه الصور داخل الكعبة وقال صلى الله عليه وسلم قاتلهم الله ما كان إبراهيم يستقسم بالأزلام. سيد صلى الله عليه وسلم قاتلهم الله made دعاء against the people of Quraysh من سيدة إبراهيم عليه السلام never used to do this. Okay, طيب. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم after that he entered Kaaba after he made sure that there is no one sonam, there is no one idol around Kaaba. Everything was taken off. ثم دخل الكعبة فصلى فيها ركعتين, prayed two ركعات. He made tawaf and he went up to الصفا made دعاء, but he didn't make tawaf between الصفا أو سعي between الصفا والمروة. He made tawaf around الكعبة but he didn't make سعي between الصفا والمروة. You know why? Anybody knows why? يعني if you go to مكة and you make tawaf only and you don't do سعي. Exactly. That's it. الطواف it's سنة تحية المسجد here. When you come to MCE, you enter MCE, you pray two rak'at. These are تحية المسجد. You go to المسجد الحرام, you do طواف. فالنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم went to the المسجد الحرام, he did طواف around الكعبة. But he didn't do سعي because سعي is one of the pillars of عمرة. And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was not doing عمرة. He was just going, يعني let's say visiting. Let's go when we go now. For example, يعني when we go for عمرة, إن شاء الله تعالى very soon, you go and you finish your عمرة. خلاص you finish your عمرة. You are in Mecca. And you went to the hotel and you're coming back. When you come back, you make tawaf. By the way, this year, they make it hard. The tawaf from down, around the Kaaba, only for people who are making umrah. If you're going just for tawaf, you go from upstairs, which is four to five times more than doing it downstairs. It's a good exercise, yeah, Muhammad.
Nine times, actually.
No?
Nine.
والله أنا مش فكر يا حاج فؤاد لأن أنا عارف. يا والله كمان الله يفتح عليك الله يقويك. طب انا كده احنا عندنا استعد يا سولي. I have somebody for you to push to. take more ajr.
It's actually better now. Like, it's not as big. The circle isn't as big.
It is big, Habib.
No, but like from last time.
From last time, then when?
Last time was huge.
When you were born? Last year was big. Last year was big. I know you were born in Saudi Arabia and you lived all of your life over there.
I mean, it's not that bad.
Yeah, for you, for all people like us, I mean, we look at it in a different perspective. He said he calculated it. So you can't say why he calculated it. You know? طيب وطاف بالبيت سبعا ولم يطف بين الصفا والمروة كما قلت. سبحان الله. One of the Sahaba, or the number one getting tortured in Mecca from the Sahaba was
Bilal.
Very good. Sayyidina Bilal. And Sayyidina Bilal was like under the huge torture and was saying all the time, Ahadun Ahad. He's one, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look, in how many, few years later, النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم asked or ordered سيدنا بلال to climb at the top of Kaaba and to make adhan. So سبحان الله Allah سبحانه وتعالى gave him that great honor after he was like, you know, he left Mecca with this, after the huge torture that he got in Mecca. أمر رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بلالا أن يصعد فوق ظهر الكعبة فيؤذن للصلاة فصعد بلال وأذن للصلاة وأنصت أهل مكة للنداء الجديد على آذانهم كأنهم في حلم الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر هذه كلمة التوحيد و done خلاص the message is we're here for delivering the الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله أخذ النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم the people to be honest with you if you're there he will go to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم to give him bay'ah to give him the pledge of allegiance I'm Muslim أخذ الناس يأتون إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم that I'm talking about the first night that he entered Mecca they came to him people men and women he gave them all he accepted all of their pledges all of the bay'ah give them the bay'ah he gave the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم the bay'ah and the women came but he never touched the women صلى الله عليه وسلم إنما قال إني لا أصافح النساء إنما قولي لامرأة كقولي لمئة امرأة يعني I don't shake hands with women what's the ruling by the way on shaking hands with women حرام متأكد طيب لا مش مكروه حرام يعني بقى احنا it depends how much you pay we can look at the fatwa بس it's حرام طيب this حديث في صحيح النسائي حديث الذي قال في صحيح النسائي
صحيح النسائي
صحيح سنن النسائي
يا
كلهم صحاح they are called صحاح okay صحيح سنن النسائي okay طيب فلما بايع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم الرجال والنساء والإسلام على الإسلام والسمع والطاعة واستقر الأمن Then he went to his Umm Hanim. Who knows Umm Hanim, by the way? And what's her significance in Islam? Yeah? Who knows Umm Hanim? There was a lady in Mecca, her name Umm Hanim. She was like mentioned in a great event.
She's a sister,
huh? She's Ali's sister? Yes, she's the daughter of, that's a good answer, good start يعني, from Amin. Umm Hanim, she was the cousin of the, cousin, right? Cousin of the Prophet ﷺ, and she was the daughter of Abu Talib. So she is the sister, or was the sister of Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib. But Umm Hanim had another significance. Something happened, great event happened from her house.
I think Prophet Muhammad ﷺ went to the Miraz.
MashaAllah.
He narrated the...
Good, good. He was in her house. When Jibreel alayhi salam came to the Prophet ﷺ, taking him for the journey of al-Isra, he was at her house. Sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Okay, Umm Hanim.
With Aisha?
No. Umm Hanim.
But not with Aisha.
He was not with Aisha. No, he was not at Aisha's place. He was actually at,
Aisha was.
Was not his wife yet.
No, she was just a young.
Yeah, she was not his wife yet. When did the Isra wal-Mi'raj happen, by the way? Right after the death of Khadijah. Right after. So that year that Ali Abu Talib passed away and Khadijah passed away, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him like that, you're with us. So it's a support to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, so he take him to the journey. So he was not married to Aisha yet. Okay? So he was at Umm Hanif house. Then he went to Al-Mi'raj. Anyway, he went to her house again. Fadl, go ahead.
Sorry, go ahead. Wasn't there a hadith that Aisha was saying when during the Miras, Isra al-Mi'raj?
Yeah, she narrated a hadith from him, yes, but she was not.
From him?
But yeah.
But she was.
No.
That she was at that night with.
No. She was not with him at that night, but she narrated a hadith from him. Okay?
Got it? The Mi'raj was in Mecca, and Aisha had a house in Medina,
yeah,
as a wife.
Exactly.
Aisha was married.
Yes, not in Mecca. So he was not married to Aisha. But she narrated a hadith from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Okay? طيب. يعني أنا, I love this discussion, meaning that the people are awake. That's good. When somebody asks me that he's listening at least. Anyway, فدخل النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, he entered the house of Umm Hanif, his cousin, and he prayed 8 rak'at. شكرا لله تبارك وتعالى. And she has two of her in-laws. They were kuffar, and they asked her for protection. فأجارهم. She went to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and told them, those are mine, please forgive them. فأجارها النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم قال قد أجرنا من أجرت يا أم هانئ. يعني we give the protection to whomsoever you give protection. So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم forgive those two people. فلما مكن. So in the next day the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, and everybody came to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, and the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم forgave everybody except, as the riwayah said, إلا أربعة رجال وامرأتين كانوا, they're not mentioned. Four men and two women. Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم told the Ansar, go kill them. They killed them. Some of them they got killed and some of them they accepted Islam. يعني حتى even those people who harmed the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, and the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم told the Sahaba to go and kill them if they find them. حتى قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ولو وجدتموهم متعلقين بأستر الكعبة. Kill them even if they are holding the curtain of Al-Kaaba. Meaning that anybody goes to Al-Kaaba is in protection. Those people, they harmed the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Some of them they got killed. Some of them they accepted Islam. And once they accept Islam, خلاص, they're done. You can't kill them. طيب. Next day the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم went, and that's the popular and the known story that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم went out to the people of Mecca and he forgave all of them. يعني, and he told them, يعني, you can go, everybody is free, I'm not here to kill anybody. But the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم gave a very clear statement that this place is sacred and no fight can be done in it. And what happened today that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it halal, made the fight halal, permissible for me for a sa'ah only, for a part of the day. And it's only for me, for Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and it's not gonna be for anybody else. So it's a sacred place and nobody can fight in it, and it will be like that until the end of the day. Okay, unfortunately, Allah al-Azim, yani those people, they don't understand the ni'mah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam yaqul, ya ayyuha al-nasu inna makkata harramaha Allah. Sacred place. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it sacred. فهي حرام بحرمة الله إلى يوم القيامة, until the end of the day. لا يحل لأحد أن يسفك فيها دما. It's not permissible for anybody to kill somebody in it. Okay? ولا أن يعضد فيها شجرة. فإن أحد ترخص بقتال رسول الله يوم الفتح. Somebody comes to you and say that, you know what? But the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم fought during فتح مكة. How come you say it's not permissible? The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم did that. فقل لهم فقولوا إن الله أذن لنبيه ولم يأذن له. It was only, the permission was only for the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, not for anybody else. وإنما أحلها الله لي ساعة من النهار. It was made permissible for me this part of the day only. It's not forever. ثم عادت حرمتها اليوم كحرمتها بالأمس ألا فليبلغ الشاهد منكم الغائب أيضا يعني again it becomes secret as it was until the end of the day. This hadith by the way in صحيح الإمام البخاري one of the authentic hadith came in فتح مكة. It happened after that that some of the people of Mecca including سيدنا سهيل بن عمرو سيدنا عكرمة بن أبي جهل وسيدنا صفوان بن أمية ووحشي سيدنا وحشي رضي الله عنهم جميعا. Those people they tried to fight a little bit here and there, but at the end they all came back to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, accepted Islam. They were great, yani great Sahaba of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And now Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam put his hand on Mecca. The Arab peninsula at that time, the Jazirat al-Arab becomes all Muslims. Everybody is coming to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now it's going to be outside the borders of Mecca and Medina and that area. What's going to happen after when the Muslims becomes great in numbers and what are the battles that we have? And we're very close, by the way. يعني, the seerah of the Prophet ﷺ ends with the death of the Prophet ﷺ. Seerah of the Prophet ﷺ. We're not talking about the Islamic history. So it ends with the death of the Prophet ﷺ. When did the Prophet ﷺ die? 13. 13. Yeah. Jazakallah khair, ya Abdullah. MashaAllah. Hatulu ya abna habiya shurab. Habibi Abdullah. 11. Mean? No, when did he pass away?
The year or the day?
The day, not the day, the year. Which year? The Prophet ﷺ passed away. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ya shabab, he made Hajj in the 10th year. Okay? After Hajj. Then he passed almost 50 days after that Hajj. So the beginning of the 11th year. After Hajj. Yani now if you look at when Hajj, yani which month? In which month Hajj, by the way? I forgot.
That year,
it wasn't
Ramadan, that year.
It wasn't Ramadan, mashallah alayhi wa sallam. Wallah halwa di. So we're talking about Dhul Hijjah, right? So Dhul Qa'dah, Dhul Hijjah, Prophet ﷺ finished Hajj and went back almost 50 days, then he passed away. So basically he passed at the beginning of the 11th year after Hijjah. So we're in the 8th. So we have 3 more years. We have few battles, Ghazwat Hunayn, we have Ghazwat Tabuk, Ghazwat Al-Usra, and we have the last few, the Hajjat Al-Wada' for sure. So we're very close to the end of the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. As I said, inshallah next week, Friday, I will be giving a lecture at Masjid Dar al-Sunnah. So I'm not going to be here, but Sheikh Yahya will be here inshallah. And tomorrow inshallah ta'ala will continue the Al-Hisab, the part of the journey to the hereafter. We finished Hajj last week, the resurrection. Tomorrow will be the accountability, how it will happen. Inshallah ta'ala, see you guys all tomorrow after Salat al-Asha. And don't forget that from Sunday, the sa'ah or the hour will be our all, 1 hour, not ahead, forward, yani. So the Asha will be inshallah not from tomorrow, Sunday, but the Asha will be 9:15 inshallah.
What's the reason that you know every single sahabi from Muhajirin?
Do you think that we know every single Sahaba from the Muhajirin?
Most of them.
Maybe I'll give you an answer from what I understand. Is how many were there when they migrated from Mecca to Medina? And there was not a huge number. If you look at how many people participated in the Battle of Badr of Muslims, 3, 14, 17, or 19, based on different riwayat, that's and don't tell me that a muhajir, somebody went from Mecca to Medina because of the oppression and there is a battle against Quraysh and he's not going to go out. So basically they were there, most of them. So we're talking about a few numbers. But when we go to Medina, lots of them, lots of the Sahaba, Al-Ansar, lots of them, and then you add to them the people from the areas, different areas. I was reading a hadith on Thursday, a nice hadith. When we read the Dr. Ahab came with us, he was with us. When you read a hadith, and hadith, for example, says that Ja'a, يعني I'm telling you, yesterday a delegation came to visit me from Calgary. The delegation has 14 people. You and I will look at it, you know what? Yeah, 14 people, خلاص. You're not going to look at what are the names of the people, who came, right? we don't pay attention to this. But the ulama, when you go to the books, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, جاءه وفد من قيس. وفد من قيس. A delegation from قيس. طيب. Imagine that the Hajar in his book, Fath al-Bari, he is actually mentioning the 14 people by name, and no one of them we know. But don't think that we know everything. We don't, even the people of Mecca, we don't know all of them, but they are there in the books. And Al-Ansar, by the way, they are all there in the books. You can get them all. Yani if you dig and you read lots, you will get more and more and more of the names of the Sahaba, whether they are Muhajirin or Al-Ansar. But I think because they were few in number, we could have like, they were more يعني, known. Yani. Allahu Akbar. Fadl al-Hamd. Yeah.
Something I heard about, I never knew about the priest, like in the early 19th, there was a fake Mahdi or something.
Yeah, not early 90s. 4 or 5 years ago, some people went to Hajj and they made that fitna and they caused lots of troubles. No, people will do it.
Like that one, there was hostages.
Yeah, I know. هو النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم made it clear that it's haram. But people, يعني أقول لك حاجة حلوة جدا. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول في الحديث الصحيح: Imagine الكعبة. Have you been? إن شاء الله you go soon. طبعا everybody been to this experience can explain that to you. Once you go to الكعبة and you look at الكعبة, you're actually in a different world. It's a different feeling. It's something amazing. Okay. طب you're looking at me now. What do I mean? يعني you're looking at Hassan. Human being like Ma'mun, like myself, like anybody. يعني, okay. يعني, what do you think I will do for humanity if I stay forever? يعني, me as human being or Al-Ka'bah, which is a great place, sacred place. What do you think? What's going to be the answer, Ashaban? A human being, person, or Al-Ka'bah? We are lots, billions of people everywhere. And I have one of my family. His philosophy is that what's happening, whether it's wrong or right, the people are lots. So when they kill some of them, we make it easy for the people. Some people, they look at it this way. Some people, they're like, they don't understand. Okay? Again, the question is, Al-Ka'ba or one human being? What do you think, Muhammad? Al-Ka'ba, صح. I like your answer. You're honest. Now, what do you think? Al-Ka'ba or one human being? Right. Like Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, one human being. And like لهدم الكعبة. He said that it's better in the eyes of Allah Subhanahu Wa Taala, or it's easier in the eyes of Allah Subhanahu Wa Taala, that this Ka'ba that you see will be demolished brick by brick than killing one Muslim. However, Ya Muhammad. Killing Muslims is like something that we like, just look. يعني you can be watching a news and a Muslim is being killed. Muslims are being killed. And after that, right away, you have a very nice meal. And you eat, like, you know, no problem. And right? I'm not saying you, but that's a human being. We get used to it. Nabi Sassam said that. So the same is said about Al-Ka'ba and about Al-Masjid al-Haram and about Mecca. It's haram. However, people, they don't respect that. They don't understand. They don't appreciate the ni'mah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives them.
What about the Hajjaj?
He killed
his son of...
Sayyid ibn
Musayyib? You know the daughter of Bakr?
Abdullah.
Abdullah ibn Zubayr.
Yeah.
I don't know where he killed him.
Was it in Mecca?
Yeah,
in Mecca, right?
They crucified him.
Yeah. خلاص انا يعني again it's the same thing يعني if somebody does not listen to the hadith or respect it doesn't mean that hadith is not there. Hadith is there, right? And the ruling is there. Okay, yalla, see you tomorrow, Saturday. Yalla, go sleep. See you tomorrow inshallah ta'ala for the journey to the hereafter. Assalamu alaikum. Jazakallah khair. Hassan, man, you start, you finish.
I got it.
Habibi Hassan, Jazakallah khair. Thanks.